Good morning and welcome to the Design Tech Show, an all things AC podcast. I'm your host, Emily Basaga-Dunn, and this morning we're going to be discussing computational and generative design chat featuring Jacob Small. So you can find Jacob on Twitter, and his Twitter handle is at Jacob W. Small. Jacob is a recovering building designer and Revit junkie. He's also a designated support specialist at Autodesk, and he, quote, dabbles in the Dynamo forums in his downtime. That is the understatement of the year, because if anybody has been to dynamobim.org, you're definitely going to know Jacob from all of the work he's put into helping everybody understand Dynamo and computational design. So the reason that I really wanted to bring Jacob on board this morning and have a discussion is recently I had the opportunity to look over his shoulder and check out this really cool optimization he's been working on for space planning. I just want to let you guys know up front, how does this space planning optimization work? In a nutshell, Jacob starts in Excel and he defines room types as well as assigns desired adjacencies and noise scores for each room. Once he's set this up, he's actually using a graph developed in Dynamo, and this room data is fed into this computational workspace, and then a series of possible room configurations are generated with Refinery, which is our generative design tool. And we're also able to visualize the room layouts. And then what's really neat is the layout that you love the most with the space planning exercise can be pushed into Revit as room separation lines and room elements. So this it lets you complete the early stage design process, and then it tees you up to start design development in Revit. And from there, I mean, the opportunities are kind of limitless. You're working in BIM, you can use cloud rendering, you can go for some project delivery using BIM 360. And so that is a quick summary, but let's get down to it. So Jacob, welcome to the studio.
Hi.
Hey there. So excited to have you here. I would really love to hear more from you about your space planning graph and, you know, how you went through the process of developing this thing.
The space planning graph, which has been on display a couple times now, basically works through basic residential space planning with a placing the various program elements along a centralized corridor. It's pretty easy to modify it to work on curves or S-shaped topographies or topologies, whatever other program you might want to lay it out to, without too many changes, and makes significant use of Refinery to sort of leverage these sort of new topics, which is pretty cool.
Okay, so it sounds like you have this incredibly high-level understanding of computational and generative design, but in case we have any folks out there listening in, what I really want to know is, when did generative design first become a thing for you, and how did you get so involved in the computational design community?
I guess that's a good question. I sort of stumbled into it without even knowing it. It sort of happened. I originally got started way back my first job out of college. I tell the story of my boss at the time coming over and giving me a plan, and we were using CAD software at the time, DataCAD actually, and saying, can you draw a sprinkler control room right here, because we need one for this strip mall. I'm like, oh yeah, sure, no problem. 2 minutes later, I had drawn the 8 lines in the door. It was like, awesome, but you gave it the wrong room number. Now that needs to be room number 101. And I brought up the fact that there already was a 101, so he made me go around and renumber all the rooms in sequence to whatever the previous number was plus one, so it was N plus one renumbering, which was very time consuming and tedious. When I'd finished the rooms, he made me go back and he made me renumber the doors and the windows and all the interior elevations and all the interior elevation tags and all the sheets and all the view names, because again, this was 2D CAD, so it was the equivalent of hand drafting, but with the computer, and it took forever. Since that day, I've always started looking for ways to do stuff faster. It took me like 2 weeks, and that was my intro to architecture. Congratulations, you got through college, and now we're going to be the most mundane task we can think of. And, you know, I got through it. It was done and never again.
Yeah, I hear
so
you.
I've been big into Revit. And then since then, automating anything and everything I can, including design tasks, be it laying out a curtain wall or, adjusting the randomized end grain blocks in the lobby or tiling patterns and whatever else.
Okay. So it sounds like you're using Autodesk tools to do automation and optimization, and specifically using Dynamo for the automation aspect and then Project Refinery for optimization, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So Dynamo is kind of the root cause for everything within the generative design tool set in the AE space at Autodesk. If you can use Dynamo, you can do a lot. We're going to be talking a lot about that this year at AU. Certainly going to be a lot of classes there. So if you can't use that, then a lot of those other pieces don't necessarily make sense. So Zach Krohn, Lily Smith, myself, others have many times shown this sort of graph of like, you are here and it's pointing at, you know, Revit. And to the right of Revit, we've got actually left of Revit, I guess I should say, we've got AutoCAD, and to the left of that, hand drawing. And then to the right of Revit, we've got Intro to Computational Design with Dynamo scaling up to what used to be Project Fractal for just bulk option generation, not necessarily optimization, before getting into design optimization with Refinery and someday down the line, machine learning, which is going to be really cool.
Right. So actually, the next thing I was going to ask you about was the space planning graph that you've been working on is really cool. It's pushing the envelope for optimization in floor plans and for architects as well as interior designers. Where do you see this graph and this workflow like along the timeline of the evolution of generative design? I know it's a big question, but I had to ask because you're Jacob Small.
I don't know. I mean, it's really thoroughly right in that realm of design optimization, because it's not just generating one outcome, it's generating multiple and ensuring that you get an optimized result, which is really nice. Mm-hmm. The amount of time that takes can be, you know, really intensive if you're doing these many sort of studies. Yeah. The hard part in all of that sort of comes, how do you teach the computer the intuition that you as a designer have sort of developed over 10, 20 years of experience?
Right.
And there's no easy way to do that. I wish I could just give you everybody the graph that just, here it is, it's the residential space planning node, and it will design it exactly the way you think, but I don't know the way you guys think. I know the way I think a little bit. And then I can sort of teach the computer from there, but we're definitely into that realm, and it's definitely sort of the stuff that's coming next.
Yeah. And so to speak to this, I just want to make sure the audience understands that really automation and optimization does not mean the exclusion of the human hand, the human voice, and, you know, our ideas and our sensibilities. So recently, actually, Jacob handed off his space planning script to me, and I got to take a look at the nuts and bolts behind the scenes in Dynamo, which was super exciting. On top of that, I was able to take his model at a schematic design level and develop it to a design development level and then run it through cloud rendering. And we have this really seamless, connected workflow. I wouldn't say it's super easy to get into computational design. It does take a lot of work. It takes some onboarding. You have to learn some scripting. And it's not just like a one click of a button kind of process, right,
yeah.
Jacob?
Yeah, it's still a process. And the designer is definitely still steering the computer. The decisions are still being made by you. It's just you're given a lot more data as you make those decisions. So, you know, do I want to put the start with the living room in this corner or here or there, or where does it want to be? Instead of having to go through and manually sketch out all those out or think through all of those manually, you basically just feed it an Excel spreadsheet and let the computer do the work from there.
Yeah.
And you can get a lot of really interesting options there that you probably wouldn't have thought through on your own, unless given kind of an infinite time set. And then once you have that, you can also make some changes as well. So there's another version of the graph where after you've sort of picked your favorite, right, and then brought that into Revit, you can sort of make some changes to the model and see if your intuition actually makes the design perform better from whatever option it is that we're evaluating. This sort of ensures that, you know, that initial gut reaction that you had to that first sketch continues along as you sort of desired.
And so what I think is really exciting, so we're describing a process that might not be an easy button type process, but it is possible to have this be a very seamless and very connected and very integrated process. So you're starting in Dynamo, you're seamlessly going to Refinery, you're able to push elements into Revit, and then you can have these amazing seamless connections to Insight or to Autodesk Cloud Rendering or to BIM 360 Design. So to me, that's the most exciting part right now about generative design, is that we're getting connected.
Yeah, and on the optimization or the automation front, those are the other sort of things that people are starting to put sort of ties into. We've seen ties released for Dynamo recently for Civil 3D as well. So if you're using Civil 3D 2020, welcome to the computational design party. we can start automating all those elements along the quarters and stuff like that. So. Within the same graph, we can now push content into not just your Revit models, but also your Civil 3D models and vice versa, all making use of that same Dynamo ecosystem that's been built up and even leveraging Refinery.
Okay, so this is gonna be a little bit of a hard right turn, but when I was looking at one of Jacob's graphs recently, I noticed there were just like dictionaries everywhere. Jacob, what is with all the dictionaries?
So the best part about computational design is you can leverage a lot of data at once. The worst part about computational design is you're going to have to leverage a lot of data at once. And the better you manage that data flow, the faster your graph's gonna sort of run. So with Dynamo 2.0 dictionaries release, which meant instead of having to call stuff by an index, I could just scream a name at it. So I could say living room, and it would pull up all the information about their living room, where the living room's located, what size the living room is, what color I want the living room to show up, what rooms need to be adjacent to the living room, all that sort of content right there. And then I can add stuff to that dictionary and pull additional values, perform calculations, update the location as stuff sort of needs to happen, which is extremely useful because it means stuff's just calculating faster and I don't have to worry about, okay, what index was that at? You know, every time I see somebody going through and, you know, open a code block and typing A index, 1, 2, 3, 4, 4, oh no, sorry, 3 because it starts at 0, close the bracket, open the bracket, 1, 2, 3, 3, okay, no, sorry, 2 because it starts at 0, close the bracket, and it, you know, that sort of stuff can sort of go away because we're able to leverage that data much more effectively by using common sense names, which is pretty cool. It's also a lot faster because there's none of that geometry previously on you.
So how hard is it technically to work with dictionaries? What is this process looking like? It's just click dictionary, how's this working?
Yeah, I mean, it's a little bit different from leveraging lists, but you still have to understand all those same concepts. So when I teach Dynamo to people who are getting started, I always start with first our basic data types, you know, what is a point versus what is a solid or a space or a string versus a double versus an integer versus a date, time, whatever you have, right? And sort of parse those pieces through to get to that next level where now that I know what data types are, what if I have multiple sets of data types? How are those organized? So we go through list levels and lacing before finally moving into dictionaries. If you get lists and you get list levels and you get lacing, dictionaries sort of follow suit. You know, people tend to pick them up pretty quick. But if you're still struggling with those kind of core concepts of Dynamo, definitely worth taking an AU class on getting back into the basics.
Yeah. Okay. So on that note, I'm really interested to hear as the submissions for AU Las Vegas are closing this evening. And, what on earth have you submitted to AU Las Vegas?
I have 6 proposals on my C drive upstairs. I've yet to hit send on any of them. The first one is around managing element binding within Dynamo. Mm-hmm. That's a topic that users struggle with like crazy. The next one, I'm not sure what the title is going to be, but it's something around like explain to me like I'm 5 basic Dynamo concepts or difficult Dynamo concepts, which will cover list lacing, levels, data types, you know, sort of the basics. And the other one that I'm really excited about is building for speed, optimizing your Dynamo graph runtimes.
Cool.
And that's going to be all about kind of introductory to computer science, which is something I've never been formally trained in it, but I've watched a lot of MIT OpenCourseWare videos and have a pretty good understanding on how, you know, get out of your n to the nth power spaces as quickly as possible.
Wow.
Otherwise, you will, you know, be staring at your computer thinking for a long time before you get your results. So.
That sounds pretty exciting.
Yeah. It'll be good. I don't know which ones will be picked, but I'm excited to see what everybody else has put together too. I know a lot of the other Dynamo community members have a lot of great courses that they've already started posting. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one of the courses that I'm hoping to be able to give in one of those 15-minute talks, you saw that new format this year,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Like the power talk.
The theater talks.
Yeah. So I'm hoping to do the business value of computational and generative design for executives. So it's not just looking at the graph, but it's looking at the time and money saved as well, and talking through how to get these things implemented in a lightning round.
Nice. Yeah, those are going to be a lot of fun. I've got another customer's looking to possibly talk about space planning for office space too.
Nice.
Perhaps at one of those, but if not there, hopefully we'll see him somewhere else at AU.
Okay. And then, so I guess we're getting close to the end of our discussion here, and I think we've covered a lot of great topics, and thank you.
No problem.
What I'm curious to know is, it's been a whirlwind since Jacob's been here at Autodesk. We've taken on a lot of amazing projects and come out the other side looking great and doing well. My question is, like, what's been an aha moment for you since coming to Autodesk in the computational generative design realm? Like, is there something you stumbled upon and been like, oh, I wish I'd known this? Or maybe what advice might you give to someone starting out in this design space?
So, The biggest sort of aha moment for me was, you always look at stuff and it always looks like it's really polished and people just sort of know what it is that they're doing. And the reality is, anybody who's good at this, they didn't go to school for it. Nobody sort of taught them, well, for the most part, didn't go to school for it, weren't taught it. They're self-taught. And if you want to learn it, the only way you're really going to learn it is by doing it. You know, take one of those classes, go through the Dynamo Primer or something like that, but don't get frustrated and think that you just can't because you can't find something. Ask questions, hit up the Dynamo BIM forums. I will say hello. You'll probably see an older photo of me when I had more hair up on the landing page somewhere. The community is really here to sort of help people out. And don't feel that just because you're in a small office or you don't have any background in it that you're going to struggle. Mm-hmm. Just do it.
And on that note, if you do want to talk to someone in person about these tools as well, we'll be at AIA Las Vegas in June. We'll also be at Built North America in Seattle later in the year, as well as Autodesk University Las Vegas. And you may or may not catch us popping into BSA events, as well as that other thing.
Oh yeah, we've got the intensive residency coming up in Toronto.
Oh, there's that one.
So yeah, eight firms enter the Autodesk Toronto office and come out with some great stuff. A lot of hackathons going on too. We just wrapped up one in, I want to say it was Sydney, but I might have the city wrong. We did the one in London recently.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of that sort of stuff going on. So look for the Dynamo team, you know, Russell, Sol, Zach, Lily, and the rest of those guys out and about in your travels.
Yeah. So I feel like that's a wrap. Any final words, any comments?
No. Guys, get with the computational design and look forward to seeing what everybody has coming up.
Thank you so much, Jacob. Awesome to have you here. So if anyone wants to get into computational and generative design, just remember, go to dynamobim.org and check out the Dynamo Primer. That's really going to be your best starting point. So you have been listening to the Design Tech Show, and we are signing off. Have a wonderful morning.